Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship here at the Reformed Church of Stout. And we are thankful that we have electricity. If you can hear the generators running just north and west of the church, there's a few houses up here that do not have power. So we're thankful that we are able to come to worship God this morning. Just a few announcements before we begin. Prayer group, if you would please meet during fellowship time. We need to do a little rearranging of our schedule. So prayer group, meet during fellowship time. Also, there is going to be a collection of various things displayed during Freedom Fest here in the church basement. So if you have items that you'd like to share, maybe you got a collection of something, or maybe you just have a few antiques from Stout or whatever it may be, we would welcome those. If you just kind of let Darlis know, she can kind of plan on how many tables and stuff to get set up. So it should be fun. That'll go and run the same time as our tractor show, so the ladies can look at the tractors, and then they can go downstairs, and the guys, when we're done looking at tractors, we can go downstairs as well. So, what? I can't say just the guys look at tractors. That, no, can't do that. Okay. All right. Stout Freedom Fest Committee is selling t-shirts. The last day to order one would be June 20th. That is this week, so if you'd like to order one, I do have the sign-up sheet downstairs. We can do that during fellowship time, or you could let me know sometime before Thursday as well. And then finally, the last thing I'd like to highlight, the replacement pages or the updated pages for our directories, church directories, are in your mailbox. So pick those up. There's also some folders or whatever that... Okay, so there's some sheet protectors that you can just put the new pages in and then slip those into your current book. So to grab a couple of those. Those are sitting on the table there in a box. So thanks, Tammy, for doing that. I did not realize there was that many updates, but yeah, there's a bunch. So somebody's going to have a little fun doing that. And yesterday I already started, so... Okay, for a nominal fee, Tammy will, no, she'll do it out of the goodness of her heart. If you don't feel like doing that, if you just put your book on her desk with the replacement pages, she'll get that all set up for you, again, above and beyond the call of duty. So, all right, that's all the regular announcements I have. Does someone have anything else? If not, let's stand and let's greet each other this morning. And I'll go get new batteries for my... Oh, now it works. Yeah.
So during the announcements, I was so entrenched in trying to figure out what needed to be said and what didn't, I failed to see that we have visitors, and we'd like to welcome the Jansons, all right? So they got to be good people, right? Yeah, so welcome, guys. It's great to have you with us. And remember, following this morning's worship, we do have fellowship time downstairs, so please join us if you have time. All right, our call to worship comes from Isaiah 63. It's not really the verses from there, but it is an offtake from Isaiah 63. I will tell of the Lord's unfailing love. I will praise God for all he has done. His promises and many acts are faithful, full of love. For he is our Father, our Redeemer, from ages past, even until this very moment. Let's pray. Indeed, O Father, we come before you on this day that we set aside to honor and remember fathers. Lord, we indeed remember you as being our Father who is in heaven. Lord, you are the perfect Father. The rest of us fathers here on earth have failed, but you never fail. And we thank you for that, and we thank you for your faithfulness as we sing of it this morning in your Son's precious name. Amen. Our opening hymn, number 44, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Come on up. You'll see why in a little bit. Uh-oh. Need a little grandma love this morning. All right, guys. So this is Gavin, guys. And last Sunday I asked Gavin if he would help me during the children's message, okay? So he's going to help out, but before we get going with this, we need a few disclaimers, okay? Just like on TV, it has to be disclaimers. So, other than the fact that I asked you to help me today, did we talk about anything what's going to go on?
No.
Uh-oh. Right up close to your mouth.
No.
There we go. All right. Are you being paid or compensated in any way for this interview this morning?
Maybe.
All right, children's sermon's over. No, there probably will be a piece of candy for you, okay? So, all right, so we're going to ask you some questions today, all right? Some of them may be easy, some of them may be difficult. Some of them you probably can answer, some of them maybe not, okay? Now, I'm not doing this to make fun of you or poke fun at you. I'm just going to make a point, okay? And I knew you could handle it. So, it's Father's Day. Mm-hmm. We're going to talk about your dad. Okay. All right, here we go. Questions. All right, should be simple. How old's your dad?
53.
Okay, when's your dad's birthday?
August 20-something, 1950, I think.
Your grandma's going.
I don't know, maybe. No, 1975. That's it.
I was he's not 1950, probably.
Yeah, I was thinking of my grandpa's birthday.
How about August 20th? Is that right? No.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, that's all right. See, like I said, you might know, you might not. Where was your dad born in a hospital? Don't count, okay?
Somewhere in Tampa Bay.
Somewhere in Tampa Bay. So that's not too bad, okay? Mm-hmm. What's your dad's middle name?
Christopher.
Christopher, very good. All right. What else? Oh, I got a good one. How many brothers and sisters does your dad have?
One brother.
One brother, okay. That was pretty easy. All right. Now, this one you can't say out loud, okay, because we don't want to give your dad's... What's your dad's Social Security number?
Shh. He doesn't like sharing that with
okay,
him.
Do you know it?
No.
Okay, all right. All right, let's see. Look, can I come up with one more question? Okay, one more question. This one should be pretty easy. What's your dad's favorite food?
He's got a lot. He likes Greek, Indian.
Greek and Indian? Okay. All right, so he's more of the...
He can eat anything.
He can eat anything. Well, most of us guys can, right? All right, good job. Thank you. All right, now you got to stay here, though, because I do want to give you a piece of candy when we're done. All right, so how did he do? Pretty good? He did, right? I'm impressed, okay? But did he know everything about his dad? No, okay? Today we're going to talk about our Heavenly Father, about God, and how oftentimes we may know some things about God. We may know quite a few things about God, but there are things about God that we do not know. Some of them are in God's Word, and we can find the answer. Some of them are just some hidden mysteries about God that the only way we're going to find out is one day when we see him in heaven, okay? But God wants us to get to know him even better, okay? And we do that by reading his word. So thanks, Gavin. Let's pray. Father God, we just thank you. We thank you for Gavin. We thank you for his willingness to have a little fun this morning. Lord, we just thank you for the boys and girls as well. And Lord, we just pray indeed that that all of us, would desire that we would try to learn more and more about you. And as we open your word this morning, as we discover how you have revealed yourself to us, Lord, may we take it into our hearts and may we take it home and may we share it with those that we would meet around us. In your son's precious name, amen. All right. So since you were such a good sport, you get to go first. All right. Let's see. We're going to start down here with a couple girls, okay? You're welcome. Oops, not that one. that good? Grandma, you want one? No, okay. All right, Arnie and Martha have picked out our special music. Perfect. Thank you, guys. Fits in wonderful. Let's pray. Our Father, we do come before you now. And Lord, we can use those words, our Father, because Jesus is praying it with us even now. We thank you that you are a Father that loves us, a Father that cares about us, a Father that knows everything about us, and a Father who wants us to come before you and talk to you. Lord, as we open now your word, as we read these words out of our hymn book, Lord, may you open them, that we may see them clearly as what you would have us to learn. And Lord, we just thank you again, especially for your love for us. Your love that was so great that you gave your only son to die for us. It is because of that, because of your love, and because of his devotion to you that we are here this morning. And we pray it in his precious and holy name. Amen. Our scripture comes from the hymn book this morning, page 733, if you'd like to read there. And I'm assuming that Lee is going to have it on the screen as well. It is in the form of a responsive reading, and I'd like to read it that way. I will read the smaller print, and you can respond with the bolder print from various portions of God's Word. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Listen to your father's instruction, pay attention, and gain understanding. We have all had human fathers who disciplined us, and we respected them for it. Our fathers disciplined us for a little while as they saw best. If you know how to give good things to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? How great is the love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called children of God. O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay. You are the potter. We are the work of your hand. Amen. As I was beginning to prepare for this Father's Day message, my mind began to think of which fatherly biblical figure I would like to speak about this year. As I've shared many times, preparing Mother's Day and Father's Day messages maybe are one of the most difficult things for me. Not because I didn't have a wonderful mother and father. Not that I don't know wonderful fathers and mothers. But rather, in the back of my mind, I think of those that maybe were not so fortunate. Those that had a father or a mother that could have did much better. Or maybe someone in the audience today has not been blessed with children and they themselves are not really considered fathers or mothers. And I wonder how sometimes they feel when I speak to them. In J.J. Packer's book, Knowing God, Packer stresses the importance of really getting to know the God that we serve. Yet many don't really know him. Oh, they may know a few of the Bible stories, a few of the basics, but actually it is a very shallow knowledge. We might say just enough to get by. And Packer asks this question, do we truly desire a full knowledge of God? And if so, what things must happen? And he points out two things. First, that we must recognize how much we lack the true knowledge of God, just as I tried to point out with the kids this morning and Gavin. But also that we must seek God in a deeper way than we ever have before. Allowing what we learn to go deep into our hearts and then to allow the Holy Spirit to help us to use that knowledge to transform our lives and to share our Father with others. But what does getting to know God really involve? And Packer says there are three things in his mind. First, that we must listen always to God's Word. Second, that we must allow the Holy Spirit to interpret that word and then allow him to apply it into our personal lives. And third, that we must use the things that we have learned to lead us into a divine and deeper fellowship with God our Father in heaven. After all, God made us to know him. He's not a supernatural being. He's not an angel. He's not some make-believe creature that's way out there. He is Father, Father God. He is our Father. God's Word contains so much information about him. In fact, each book reveals something particular about his nature, about who he is, how he wants us to view him, even to the point of the name that he wants us to call him. And so, this morning, we are going to go through the entire Bible. 66 books, 39 Old Testament, 27 New Testament books, and we are going to see how each author paints a portrait of who God is and how he has revealed himself to us. Today I'm going to take you through that entire book from Genesis to Revelation. We're going to go through all 66 books, and I'm going to have you out of here in time. Okay? This is going to be kind of a rapid-fire message this morning, and I thought about maybe having an outline, and you could fill in the words, but as I thought about that, when I used to do that, when I sat in the pew and I was trying to figure out what to put in the outline, I had missed the next 3 points the pastor already was getting at. So if you would like an outline of this morning's message, Tammy and I, and she doesn't know this yet, we will get one printed up for you, and you can have it, so just ask me. But do you know the God you serve? Do you really know him? In Genesis, he is the creator, the seed of the woman. In Exodus, he is the Passover lamb. In Leviticus, he is the great high priest. In Numbers, he is the cloud by day and the fire by night. In Deuteronomy, he is the prophet. In these 5 books we call the Pentateuch, the law. Do you know the God you serve? In Joshua, he is the captain of the Lords of Hosts. In Judges, he is the great judge. In Ruth, he is the kinsman redeemer. In 1 and 2 Samuel, he is the great and reigning king. In 1 and 2 Kings, he is the still small voice. In Ezra, he is the pleading one. In Nehemiah, he is the rebuilder of the walls of salvation. In Esther, he is the unseen hand. In Job, he is the living redeemer in the dayspring. In Psalms, he is the shepherd and the strong power. In Proverbs, he is wisdom. In Ecclesiastes, he is the fiery preacher. In the Song of Solomon, he is the lovely one. In these 17 books, the books of history in the Old Testament, do you know the God that you serve? Moving on. In Isaiah, he is the wonderful counselor. In Jeremiah, he is the weeping one. In Lamentations, he is the final authority. In Ezekiel, he is the watchman who is upon the wall. In Daniel, he is the fourth man in the fire. In these 5 books, the major prophets, do you know the God that you serve? In Hosea, he is the bridegroom. In Joel, he is the baptizer of the Holy Spirit. In Amos, he is the burden bearer. In Obadiah, he is the mighty Savior. In Jonah, he is the ambassador. In Micah, he is the ruler of all nations. In Nahum, he is the avenger of God's elect. In Habakkuk, he is the great evangelist. In Zephaniah, he is the restorer of the remnant. In Haggai, he is the chosen one. In Zechariah, he is the Lord of hosts. And in Malachi, he is the fulfillment of all prophecy. In these 12 books, the minor prophets, do you know the God that you serve? Moving to the New Testament. In Matthew, he is the Messiah. In Mark, he is the miracle worker. In Luke, he is a suffering Savior. In John, he is the Son of God. In these 4 books, the Gospels, do you know the God that you serve? In Acts, he is the builder of the church. In this book of history, do you know the God you serve? In Romans, he is the sanctifier. In 1 and 2 Corinthians, he is our sufficiency. In Galatians, he is the one who sets us free. In Ephesians, he is the cornerstone. In Philippians, he is the name that is to be above all names. In Colossians, he is the fullness of the Godhead, the Trinity, the 3-in-1. In 1 and 2 Thessalonians, he is the soon and coming King. In 1 and 2 Timothy, he is the mediator between God and man. In Titus, he is the blessed hope. In Philemon, he is our friend. In Hebrews, he is the blood that washes away the sin of the world. in Paul's letters, these 14 books, do you know the God that you serve? In James, he is the great physician. In 1st and 2nd Peter, he is the bishop of all souls. In 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, he is the word of life. In Jude, he is our Savior. In these seven books, the general epistles, do you know the God you serve? And in Revelation, he is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. In this final book of prophecy, do you know the God that you serve? A whirlwind tour, 66 books. Some of those names, I'm sure to you, sound very familiar, right? Some of them, maybe not so much. At least it was that way with me. Some of the names seem to be in agreement with each other, right? A God of love. There's much agreement. But some of the names do not seem to be in agreement. In fact, they may seem to be in total contradiction. How can a God of love be a God that is just and a God that judges? Nevertheless, these names, as revealed to us in God's word, remember, God's word, right? He gave it to the writers to write down. They didn't write it on their own accord. This is God our Father this morning. Now, how can we relate that to fathers today? Well, first of all, I'm going to, before I go any further, say, dads, we don't match up to God our Father, all right? We can't. We're sinners. We all know that, okay? Our Father is perfect. His will for us is perfect. He knows everything about us. Even the things that he sends to us are not intended to harm us or to hurt us, but they're intended for our good. And I'm sure each of us who are a father here today would humbly have to say we weren't always that way to our kids. We tried. Most often, I believe we did our best over this, although sometimes I think we, if we would totally be honest with ourselves and with others, we could have did better. But this is God. God who is so great and so infinite and so mysterious that we will never really know everything about him until that final day when we meet him face to face, and then everything will be made clear to us. As I visit with you gentlemen, for the most part, often before church, we talk about things that we don't understand. And I believe we've each said at one point or the other, when I get to glory, I have a lot of questions for God. Right? I'm in that boat with you. But as I thought about these things this morning, about how God reveals himself to us, I'm pretty sure I'm not going to have to ask the question. He's going to give me the answer without asking. And maybe he's not even going to have to say it out loud. Maybe it will just be given to me and I will totally understand. This is the God that we serve. A God that today we cannot totally understand. As the scripture says, now we look through a mirror or a glass dimly, but then we will see him face to face. But that does not give us an excuse, ladies and gentlemen, this morning to not try to learn more about Jesus Christ, about God the Father, and about the Holy Spirit. We must be in his word daily, seeking out what God would want us to learn from him each and every day. Now, there's one little thing I need to add. Sometimes I wish I had the answers. You folks too? Sometimes, and as I am pastor here longer and your friendships become more dear and I get to know you and love you more and more, there are things that happen in this church family that I don't understand. I don't know why. And I would say I wish that I had the answer for you when you ask that question, why, but I don't. And the more I think about that, I don't think I want to know. Adam and Eve had just been created in Genesis. God had given them the entire world, so to speak, except for a small area in that garden. And he says, I want you to stay away from that. Don't you even go near it. Right? And Satan comes along and says, did God really say that? I mean, if you eat of that fruit, you're going to know God better. If you eat of that fruit, you may be as smart or have as much wisdom as God himself. Wouldn't you really want to know that, Adam and Eve? Wouldn't you want to know that about your father? You see where I'm going with this? There are certain things that we are never going to understand in this world, and it's because we can't. We can't. Our minds cannot comprehend it, for one thing. But the other thing is, God is so high and mighty that knowing those things would be detrimental to us. It may even kill us. That's why in the Old Testament, God would not allow people to look upon him because they would drop dead. Now, I don't know if that makes matters any easier for you or not. But for me, just knowing that God is so great, that God is so awesome, that God is all-knowing, that God's will is ultimate, it is final, and most of all, that God loves you and me. For now, that needs to be enough. You know, there were times when my dad was raising me that I shook my head many a time and I went away mumbling and grumbling. I was not pleased with my dad. I didn't understand why in the world we had to pick up rocks and walk beans and paint corn cribs. I didn't understand it. And those are all physical things, right? Those are all minor things. When we're talking about God, we're talking a whole nother realm. But I didn't understand it. I didn't understand why I had to go to church twice a Sunday, morning and evening. I didn't understand why I had to go to catechism and do all those other things. There were times I didn't want to go. And now I wish I had my dad back to say thank you. See, there is a wisdom in fatherhood. A wisdom that only time can help with. That experiences can help with. That just gaining wisdom about God our Father, most importantly, can help with. May we thank God today for our earthly fathers. No matter how they did or how we thought they did as a job of being our dads. And most importantly, may we praise God that we are a child of His, a child of the King. Amen. Let's stand and let's sing that hymn, number 361, I'm a Child of the King.
The world in his hands, a room.
Amen. You may be seated. A few updates and prayer concerns that we have before I ask for yours from the congregation this morning. Roger Meester was transferred from Allen to Grundy Hospital this Wednesday for further recovery and rehabilitation. We went and visited him yesterday. He's experiencing a lot of pain. Things aren't going real good physically as far as the recovery goes, but we had a nice visit. His mind seemed much clearer than the last time we'd seen him. He's lonely, all right? That's not Fran's fault. That's not his family's fault, all right? But he's lonely because he's laying in a hospital bed, right? And that's basically, I mean, he gets up once in a while. But if you can work time into your schedule for a card, because he mentioned getting cards, I think he'd like that. Or better yet, if you could spare an hour and just go and visit with him, he will be blessed, and I promise you, you will too. So we just pray that the Lord will indeed help to heal him now. And get him hopefully back upright at least somewhat, right, Fran? Right? We talked yesterday, maybe a walker wouldn't be so all bad. I don't think he agrees with that, but that's fine, okay. All right, pray for Lois Fisher. She's down at General Synod in Arizona, and if you think it's hot here in Iowa, if you've looked at the weather forecast down there, it is sultry down there. So pray for her as they continue this. Today they will be doing mainly worship together, and then they will begin to take up the final things as far as electing a new vice president for the coming year, which next year, that person will be our president of the RCA. So a very important decision to be made there. Continue to pray for Carrie and Eunice and Lois, and also for others with health concerns. We think of Roger and Dale, of Don and Leanne and others who continue to have ongoing health issues. So does anyone have anything else? Yeah. Wow. Aiden. All right, so Norm and Tootie. Yeah, right? You're Tootie with me. I'm sorry, Katie. our proud great-grandparents of a 10th grandchild, great-grandchild, Aiden Asher. So congratulations, guys, and we pray that God will bless him and his family. So anything else? Yeah, Sandy? All right. So off your blood thinner. That's good. You won't bleed or bruise so easily. All right. Carolyn? Okay. Okay. Right. I do thank God for that. Right? The joy of weddings, the joy of fulfilling what God has designed for mankind. So, amen. Anything else? Christine? Okay, so Christine's sister Penny, right? Did I hear that? Okay, is in intensive care, so we'll pray that God will grant healing for her. Anything else? Yeah, Dolores? Okay. Okay. Okay, so you're going down, so that's good, right? We pray that that will still help you, and hopefully a few less side effects. So, yeah, prednisone, it's a wonderful thing, but it can also do nasty things to the body. So, anything else? If not, let's come before our Lord and pray. Father, we come before you, and we thank you for being our Father. And we can call you our Father because you are the Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and we thank you for being his Father. We thank you for that plan of salvation that you worked out through him. Lord, we thank you for being able to gather together this morning and to worship and to praise you. We thank you for our earthly fathers, Lord. Lord, we also thank you for new life. We thank you for little Aiden. We just pray that you will be with his family, Lord. May you bless them all with health and just the wonders of new life. We thank you too, Lord, for weddings and other celebrations that we can enjoy. Lord, you have put us upon this earth to enjoy the good things that you have for us. and we thank you for them. But Lord, we also know that upon this earth there are trials and there are tribulations. We would pray for Roger Meester. We'd pray for Fran, Lord, and the rest of their family as they go through this difficult time. We indeed would pray for healing for Roger, Lord, that you would help him to recover and regain strength if it be your will. Lord, we'd pray for people to show their love and concern to him. And Lord, I'd pray too that you would just help the time to go by a little bit faster for him. Lord, we think of Penny. We just pray that you would bless her, Lord. We pray for healing. We think of Chris as she goes through this with her as well. We just pray that you will bless them and their family. Lord, we think of those that are struggling with various health issues. We think of Roger Bergman and of Dale and of Don and Leanne, Lord. We just pray that you would bless them, especially those who are struggling with cancer. Lord, we thank you for being able to allow Dolores to cut back on her prednisone. We pray that it indeed would be a good thing for her, and Lord, that her body would respond well to the lower dosage. We praise you that Sandy is off her blood thinner. We thank you, Lord, that you have brought her through some trying times this year. Lord, we would pray that you would be with our shut-ins for Carrie and Eunice and Lois. Lord, we just pray that you would bless them. Their bodies have failed, Lord, and they can't join us anymore. But, Lord, I know that you are still working in their lives. And even though sometimes their minds may be clouded, yet, Lord, I know you are there, and they know that you are there as well. Lord, we pray for Lois Fisher and the rest of the delegates, Lord, as they are attending General Synod. We just pray that you would bless their efforts. Lord, I pray that you would keep them all safe in the heat. Lord, I would also pray that in everything that is said and everything that is done, in every vote that is cast, that your will would be done, that your word would be upheld, and Lord, that they indeed would be people that know you, not just the things they want to know or maybe have already learned, but that they would know you even better. Lord, we thank you for all these things. We thank you for taking care of us through another week. We thank you for the rain of last night. Lord, indeed, we are so blessed. And most of all, Lord, we are blessed by your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you humbly for him. And we pray again that prayer that he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This morning, as we present our offerings, please stand and rise for our doxology and prayer. And after that, if you would be seated, please. Norma's going to read about the hymn, Faith of Our Fathers. So let's stand. Father, indeed, we thank you for blessing us. Lord, we know just as our earthly fathers have blessed us and given to us, so you have even more so. And as we return a small portion, may you use them for the furtherance of your kingdom. We thank you, Father, in your Son's precious and holy name. Amen. Norma, if you'd come up and read about the hymn, and after she has finished with that, we will stand and sing Faith of Our Fathers.
Faith of Our Fathers. Often we fail to realize the great price many of our forefathers paid to establish and preserve the Christian faith. It is good for us to be reminded often that the history of the Christian faith is a rich heritage of countless people whose faith in God was considered more dear than life itself. Much could be said about the first century Christians and their persecution by the Roman Empire, or even the religious persecutions of our American forefathers in their quest for a new land where they could enjoy religious freedom. The faith of our fathers referred to in this hymn, however, is the faith of the martyred leaders of the Roman Catholic Church during the 16th century. Although he was raised as a Calvinist and later was a minister in the Anglican Church, Frederick Faber left the state church and joined the Roman Catholic Church fold. He became known as Father Wilfrid. Faber began to make it his life's mission to write hymns that promoted the history and teachings of the Catholic Church. Frederick Faber wrote 150 such hymns before his early death at the age of 49. His Faith of Our Fathers text first appeared in 1849 in the author's collection, Jesus and Mary, or Catholic Hymns for Singing and Reading. It was always Faber's hope that someday England would be brought back to the papal fold. The three stanzas found in our hymnals, however, are very usable for evangelical worship and can be reinterpreted to challenge our commitment and loyalty to the gospel that our spiritual fathers often died to defend.
Let's stand. Faith of our fathers. Just a reminder that we do have fellowship following our morning's worship. Please join us for a time of just greeting each other and being with one another in fellowship. Hear God's benediction, and now may the Lord, our Father, be with you until we meet again. And all God's people said,
Amen. Our closing chorus, The Family of God.